they have the carotids and the hypersensitivity. If you press the carotid right on in the neck or suddenly moving the neck or even without that also, suddenly goes into the assisto. These patients, elderly patients, they fall repeatedly. Sometimes they deny. They think they fall because something stumbled and fell down. Or they get investigated as repeated MRIs and CTs and EEGs and taking antibiotic medication. Ultimately they have carotids and hypersensitivity. This is what a special pacemaker will take care of that. So while doing tilt table, we do carotid sinus also, both the supine and standing, and we'll document the continuous recording ECG. Any pause more than 3 seconds, it's significant. In spite of all which I showed, the list of investigations, we may not able to arrive concrete evidence what is the cause for that particular syncope. In those patients, we put implantable loop record, which is like a pen drive. We subcutaneously will just bury it, which gives life of 3 years, which continuously monitor the cardiac rhythm. So those patients getting once in 3 months, once in 6 months, all other investigations are negative, still you are not very sure it's going to be the benign one. So this gives us an idea. So these are two things. Any abnormality in the rhythm, either brady or tachy, the device automatically reports that. Our patient also can activate this device whenever he gets symptoms. So either way, the patient will come back to you. We can interrogate from outside like a pacemaker. It gives as there is any event. When during symptoms or even the asymptomatic period, any VT, VF or any asystole or any bradyarrhythmia is documented, then that gives, we can decide the treatment. If it is a brady, pacemaker is the treatment. If there is any tachy, either ablation or ICD will be the treatment of choice. So this life comes for 3 years. So the infrequent episodes, so sometimes patient getting injured, we are not able to find out the exact cause, we can do that. So therapy, pacemaker or ICD. If it is a benign one, no problem, we can always explain the preventive measures, vasovagal and vasodepressor thing. So who needs an EP study? In a summary, so those who are suspected or documented tachyarrhythmia patients, we need EP study, and then subsequent results in the same city we can do RF ablation. Or suspected bradyarrhythmias, so all the non-invasive modality is not able to give a clue. If you want to assess the sinus node function, we can assess. If you want to assess the AV node conduction, if you are suspecting intermittent AV block, but we are not able to prove that, we can do AV conduction study or syncope evaluation. Suppose LV dysfunction, all the invasive non-negative, we are suspecting VT could be the cause for the syncope. So we can induce VT, there is inducible VT there or not. We can take up the patient for doing EP study, we can induce ventricular tachycardia and see. We can, those who are survivor of sudden cardiac arrest, we are not able to find out the cause why they have sudden cardiac arrest, we can do EP study also to any inducible life-threatening arrhythmias are there or not. So these are the category of patients we need an EP study. So in summary, those who have tachyarrhythmia, if they are supraventricular, we need therapy nowadays. Radio frequency ablation is safely can be performed, and it is success rate more than 90% in many of arrhythmias, almost 95%. Patient need not take any medication. If it is a ventricular, then medical management, ICDs, radio frequency ablation, all the treatments are available for this ventricular tachycardia. Especially structurally normal heart, ventricular tachycardia, we go with radio frequency ablation. Structurally abnormal heart, like post-MI, we go for ICD plus medical treatment. After that, if the patient gets recurrent episodes, then we go for radio frequency ablation. Or bradyarrhythmias, either due to sinus node dysfunction or AV block, treatment of choice in a symptomatic patient is a pacemaker therapy. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Karthikesan, for your nice and very useful presentation. I hope our members and other doctors will be benefited by this talk. Any questions from the audience?
What is the type of ICD?
Mitral prolapse, the problem is many patients come with palpitation, mitral prolapse. But as such, the stretching of papillary muscle sometimes produce can be deep, but it is not very common. This, most of the patients come to us with the palpitation, is all anxiety related. This morphonoid habitus patient with MEP, with a lot of palpitation, most of the time it is sinus tachycardia. Life-threatening arrhythmias due to mitral prolapse are very rare. So any arrhythmia can happen, actually any other patient can happen to the MEP patient also. Nothing like specifically this arrhythmia happens only to the MEP or nothing like that. But because of too much of stretching to the papillary muscle, sometimes VT can occur, but it is not a very considerable risk of MEP is creating VT, nothing like that.
How packet friendly is your procedures?
package.
How package friendly?
Pocket, yes. So this is radio frequency. There is a two, I showed two settings. In the simple arrhythmias, what AVNRT, AVRT, we just one day stay with the 50,000 rupees, we finish it up. And complex arrhythmias like atrial fibrillation, ventricular tachycardias, so it needs 2 to 3 days stay, and it may cost about 1.5 lakhs. If we use the 3-dimensional mapping system, it cost about 1.5 lakhs.
Pacemaker?
Pacemaker, of course, I told you, so a lot of varieties are available. Simple basic model pacemaker starts about from 1 lakh rupees, including hospital stay, procedure, everything, 1 lakh. Then higher and higher, and now the MRI compatible top end models are available, it comes up to 3 lakhs.
So, injection,
Zylocaine,
does it have any effect on
the
visual effect?
Zylocard, we use Zylocard. So that has a ventricular tachycardia, especially ischemic ventricular tachycardias, we use a treatment of choice. So sometimes patients are not responding to iodine, sometimes the response to Zylocard also. Or it can be used as a first drug of choice also in a patient. But unfortunately nowadays in the availability of iodine, people are not much using Zylocard. Previously it was very used very commonly. Nowadays iodine is preferred. But in settings we prefer Zylocard also.
Doesn't have any untoward effect, can we continue for 3 months, 6 months?
Yeah, we can. No, nothing, how long? That depends upon the what patient needs. The patient, first of all, needs long term amiodarone therapy.
First of all, is not cost effective.
So, it is a costly one thing, and what the literature says is less than 200 milligram less likely to cause long term side effects. If you give more than 200 or more than that, but we have seen 200 patients, those who are taking 200 milligram coming back to us with thyroid and lung problem. But if you give less than like 100 milligram, less likely to develop long-term toxicity. But we have to take a call whether the patient really needs long-term therapy with amiodarone.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What about
PA fibrillation?
Yeah.
Long QT, then, the long QT has a different types, long QT 1, 2, 3, up to now 10, 12 lots is going on. But what most of the 90% of the cases fall into first three categories, long QT 1, 2, 3. So long QT 1 and 2 likely to respond to the beta blockers. We have to put them on beta blockers. Good bit of beta blockers we have to put it. Long QT 3 is less likely to respond to beta blockers, but we don't have a choice, we can give still beta blockers to that patient. But the thing is, long QT 1 and 2, we have to avoid all the strenuous exercise, all these things. We should tell the patient not to participate in sports activities. But long QT 3, death can occur at sleep also. So that we can't prevent it. But patient's recurrence symptoms, in spite of good bit of beta blockers, then you have to consider for cervical sympathectomy to cut the adrenergic discharge. Still, if the patient gets symptoms, unfortunately, we don't have very few people to do that procedure. If that is not the case, or patient already having recurrence in COPE or a survivor of sudden cardiac arrest, then you have to go for an ICD implantation. Drugs plus ICD implantation. The drug of choice, most of the lung QTs are beta blockers. You have to keep heart rate is normal also.
What is your
No, Donitron, you don't have much experience. It's available just not even a month over, it's available in the market. And it's very expensive also. One tablet is 90 rupees, so we have to take 2 tablets per day, so it's 190 rupees. So you are not going to start for each and every patient which you are seeing. So, but their claiming is definitely it is inferior to amiodarone. It's not going to superior to amiodarone, but in efficacy wise, side effect wise, it doesn't have the side effect of amiodarone. But once the efficacy is less, then we have other drugs like propafenone, flecainide, all these things we are not using for commonly because efficacy is less. So this drug also falling into that category only, not falling into amiodarone or superior to that. So we have to wait and see. So how our patients are going to tolerate that. It has a lot of GI side effects, diarrhea, all these things. How our patients are going to respond, we have to wait and see. That's a good question. Patient already on beta blocker, which I showed one patient, for some other reason, for hypertension or DCM or some other reason, already on beta blocker, if they developed tachyarrhythmia, So you are not in a position to increase the drug. You are already maximum drugs you are giving. Suppose 10 milligram of Nebivolol or 10 milligram of Bisoprolol you are giving. Patient is getting tachyarrhythmia. Better go for an ablation. So you may not do the resting heart rate itself is 55-60. You are not going to increase further the beta blocker. So better to evaluate and treat that arrhythmia. Digoxin is we recommend digoxin is the problem with digoxin is it is controls the rate at rest. It will not control the rate during exercise. It can be preferred those who are sedentary lifestyle, elderly patient not doing. But its effectiveness in active patient is very very limited. So it can be combined with either beta blocker or calcium channel blocker. First of all, in heart failure, atrial fibrillation, in a structural heart disease should be corrected. In case of mitral stenosis, obstruction should be relieved, either form of PTMC or this thing. After relieving that also, patient is getting heart failure, then you have to choose a drug. Digoxin can be tried, beta blockers after controlling the heart failure, beta blocker or calcium channel blocker should be given. Sometimes patient may not respond, you may end up giving amiodarone to control the rate also. Not because of rhythm control, but to control the rate. You may have, suppose frank congestive heart failure, you are not in a position to introduce beta blocker, but still you want to control the rate. So you may have to give digoxin plus amiodarone. So till the patient comes out of heart failure, then later part you can introduce the beta blocker. Overdrive pacemaker, it suppress only this atrial fibrillation, of course we cannot use. Atrial flutter can be used to determine the tachycardia. So that can be used if it is available. For some other arrhythmias can be, especially re-entries, arrhythmias or automaticity, you can suppress only, you may not able to terminate, you can suppress it. But re-entries can be terminated. Yeah, that is a good question. We are getting benign, so-called benign. We are getting more and more reports that patients should be close. We did not give any medication, but they should be followed very frequently, in the sense it can cause tachycardia myopathy. Nowadays, too many frequent VPCs, asymptomatic patients, they can get into LV dysfunction. So they need close follow-up, at least once in 6 months on echo. So if they are going for LV dysfunction, then even if they are not symptomatic, it needs treatment. If they don't have symptoms, no deterioration LV function, it is acceptable limit, so then we can leave them alone. Yeah, ETL is a good question. These patients, there are a lot of things. We don't know exactly. These patients may be early stage of ARVD, they say arrhythmogenic right ventricular dysplasia. So the early stage, sometimes a lot of ectopics and this sort of arrhythmias can come. But as such, they are not fulfilling any criteria of ARVD now. But they need regular follow-up in future whether they develop or not. And yeah, of course, we have done MRI for that patient to rule out any such problem even before taking the patient for ablation. The way she was getting that arrhythmia, so I ruled out at present. But I need close follow-up whether she will develop or not in future.